enabling the digital economy.
Hello everyone. We are Team CMU Excelsiors. We are here to tell you all that we all have a problem. But before that, I want to ask you a very simple question. Is there anyone in this room who does not have a bank account? Can you please raise your hand? No, right? All of us who have bank accounts, the problem is that someone, somewhere in this world, is trying to access your sensitive banking data just as we speak. Now, that definitely gets me nervous. That's why we are here to introduce the Security Pentagon, our solution to data security in the world of open banking. According to Info Security Magazine, banks are 300 times more vulnerable to cybersecurity attacks. Banks also tie up with third-party providers to give their customers a range of value-added services. The problem is that if banks choose a risky third-party provider, that might just add to that vulnerability score that you see. That's why we came up with the Security Pentagon. This helps banks in accrediting the third-party providers, in giving them risk scores, as well as monitoring the APIs of these providers. It is a five-step model or a framework where the first step is standardization of the APIs, followed by establishing the terms of the data sharing contract, implementing technical solutions, accreditation of third-party providers or TPPs, and finally, regular audits.
The first step is the standardization of the APIs. The standards could be set by either a consortium of banks or some standard setting organizations such as ISO. This is important for two reasons. First, it gives a fair competitive advantage or environment to all the TPPs who are building their products. And second, it gives a fair ground of assessment to all the banks who are going to adjust the TPP APIs.
The next step in our framework is establishing the terms and conditions of the data sharing contract. Now, before the TPPs start building these applications for the banks, it's essential that they have some sort of a contractual obligation with the banks. This contract should have two essential things. First of all, it should determine the scope of the data that the banks are willing to share with the third-party providers. Secondly, the banks need to have some sort of a time frame determined for the third-party providers up to which they can hold the customer's data. This is essential in determining accountabilities if there is a data breach in the future. Also, whenever it comes to sharing a customer's information with any third-party provider, the golden rule for banks is less is more.
The next step is the technical implementation of our framework, which starts with the API lifecycle management, which has three steps: develop, consume, and monitor. The TPPs would develop their applications based on the standards set by the consortium of banks, as we discussed before. Once the TPPs have published their APIs successfully, the banks are going to test those APIs based on some dummy data. And last and the most crucial step is the monitoring step, where the banks need to assess the behavior of the TPP APIs based on some important factors, such as the traffic management, the strength of the encryption or the decryption algorithms they have used, the authentication using OAuth2 technologies, and lastly, the data analysis.
The next step is the model that will predict the risk associated with the third-party providers. Now, this is very similar to how credit risk scores of customers are calculated. The first step is that we determine the parameters on which we'd like to train our model. Those parameters would be the responsiveness to intrusion detection, like maybe DDoS attacks or SQL injections. The next parameter would be the underlying encryption mechanisms of the third-party providers. The next thing would be security management history of the third-party providers that would include for how long have they been associated with different financial organizations. Also, if there have been any data breaches related to this third-party provider. Also, we take into account the performance testing results when we are calculating the risk scores. Once we determine all these parameters, we'd like to feed it into our machine learning model and assign weights to each of these parameters. This will help us in coming up with a risk prediction score, which will then be fed into our flagging algorithm, which Sudhanshu will explain in the next step.
So after we have the risk score from a machine learning model, we combine this risk score with a threshold. This threshold could be set by either a consortium of banks or ISO. This combination helps the bank to categorize the TPPs in three categories: high risk, medium risk, and low risk. This helps the banks to screen the TPPs and decide whether or not to work with them or not.
The next step is the security audits.
The banks would conduct regular audits for all the TPPs to ensure that the risk factor is compliant with the security standards, and also none of the TPPs are holding data back beyond the period that has been mentioned in the data sharing contract as we discussed before.
Now that brings us to the end of our five-step model. The next question that we'd like to address is, why should the banks adopt our security pentagon? Well, this framework is holistic and a smart way for banks to choose the third parties that have robust and attack-resistant applications. Also, the banks can monitor them in real time and come up with certain standards so that if there are any anomalies or any unusual behaviors that the banks notice, they can flag that particular transaction and then reassess and revisit that whether this could have been a sort of an attack or not. To conclude, in this world of open banking, the banks need to adapt our security pentagon framework so that customers like you and me do not have to worry about the safety and security of our data. Thank you. Do we have any questions?